So I want to walk you through today a project that we've done in biofitness, and we've done it for a couple of years now. And every year we modify it a little bit, but and this year we're going to modify it dramatically, and I'll talk about that in a bit. But it gives you a good overview of what's generally in a project. This is a project that I designed in partnership with the New Tech Network as part of what was called the Teacher Design Group. So they had chosen 20 teachers throughout the network to collaboratively develop a high quality project library. And so part of that was they pulled us out throughout the year and took us to trainings and helped us become better teachers ourselves, helped us add more detail to projects where sometimes there might have been gaps. So this is a quote. The big problem equals good is a quote that a student said after a presentation from a guest speaker one day, and I loved it. I thought it was awesome because that is the kind of attitude that I hope our graduates leave with, and they see problems as opportunities, whether it's a design opportunity or it's an opportunity as an entrepreneur or an opportunity to learn from other people. So we'll go ahead and jump in. So again, my team teacher and I, he's also my husband, Tom Wolf, we were teacher designers, and we were commissioned to design these high quality projects, and they had to include these major individual written components. And we'd always had some written component in a project, but it had to be something that was really going to be challenging and took a lot of revision and a lot of effort to produce. So it wasn't just one draft that was produced. And we used it as an assessment of their performance in the project. And in our case, as science teachers, we had an option between scientific research or scientific inquiry. And scientific research was more typically like the research paper or a term paper that would explain something, whereas an inquiry is like documenting the process of exploring something in science. Okay, and as part of designing the project, we begin with the end in mind. As many teachers do, we start with content standards and skill objectives. And so I know you probably can't read these, but there are some biology standards here that we really wanted all of our students to have a deep understanding of. In particular, in this project, were nutrient cycling and an introduction to ecology. And also, health standards identify global environmental issues and ways to reduce pollution and harmful health effects. And then Common Core standards, we started looking at those Common Core literacy standards. We still don't have the science ones, but this project was designed with the scientific literacy standards in mind. And we really, we used these college-ready assessment rubrics that the network provided. They have a focus on content application, critical thinking, and also skills that students will need to achieve a goal. And by the way, if you have any questions or comments or criticisms, go ahead and write those down and tuck them away somewhere else. You can, of course, interrupt me. Okay. All right, and then, so the next step after we knew what we wanted students to learn is we wanted to find out what people were doing in the real world with this. And specifically in our local real world, so right in our Napa community. So we spanned a bunch of local experts in viticulture that we could find online, just as many people as possible, a college professor, vineyard managers, people who work in wineries. And we ended up having one retired viticulturalist who responded, and he told us about these site analysis reports. And they involve, they're these reports that viticulturalists compile when designing a vineyard. And they are based on soil type and chemistry, climate, pest, topography, and water. And so we met with him over the summer, and he gave us more insight on what those reports entail.
Okay. I didn't push it, sorry.
Oh, it's okay. All right, and so the project overview, once we had gotten that information, was we wanted students to determine a varietal of grape and a rootstock best suited for a certain vineyard. So luckily, we were able to get in touch with a vineyard that had a lot that they were going to be planting a new vineyard. So they agreed to partner with us for this project. and let us know that students would be, it would be great for students to provide some insight on what type of grape would do best there. And we later found we didn't know anything about growing grapes, my team teacher and I. We didn't know that rootstocks were separate from the varietal of grape. And usually the rootstock comes from Europe. And, or I'm sorry, the rootstock comes from here in California, and the varietal grape comes from Europe. So we designed the project in partnership with the viticulturalists and had students decide what would be best for this specific site. And each individual would write this very in-depth site analysis report. And teams would present their conclusions and a vineyard layout and their research to the Gamble Vineyard staff. Okay, and these are some pictures from our field day. So luckily, Gamble Vineyard was very generous. They gave us 2 buses and 8 viticulturists from throughout the valley who put on this great field day for the students. So we were able to bus out all of our freshmen, and they took soil samples. They learned all about analyzing vineyards, vineyard planning. They got to see some of the technology that the viticulturalists use on their iPads to tell which way to plant vineyards. They got dimensions of the vineyard layout. They learned a lot about pests and sustainability at the vineyard. So it was an excellent day. They took notes throughout the whole day. My team teacher and I also took very thorough notes. And when we returned to the classroom that following week, we spent a lot of time compiling the research we had gathered on that field trip so that we had a very long list of what we knew about the task at hand. And then we moved on to the need-to-knows. So we did the knows and need-to-knows after the students had some solid background knowledge from that field day. Okay, and again, here's the CRA rubric. And again, I know you can't read this. But what we really liked about it is that it focused on content depth and critical thinking skills. And it had some specific domains that we focused on. So one was constructing evidence-based arguments. So we told the students and the viticulturalists expressed to the students that they wanted to see evidence to support their stance. Also, communicating findings, so of course, writing and how well they lay out their information. And following conventions, so were they using accurate terminology? Were their calculations correct? Was their representation of what we experienced at the vineyard accurate? Okay, and the college ready assessment in this case, it was laid out a lot like a lab report would be. So it started with a purpose, and then it went into a hypothesis, data and observations, a sketch of the vineyard layout and any features of the vineyard that they wanted to include, a conclusion that answered the driving question of the project, a reflection, and also, of course, I mentioned they presented their research. That wasn't part of the report. But every individual student, our English language learners, our students with special needs, every student produced one of these very in-depth scientific research reports. And it took a lot of work. It took a lot of chunking things into smaller pieces and revision, some more than others for other students. And some of the challenges, one was time, obviously finding the time to grade all of the benchmarks. So we didn't have them do that whole paper in one as one assignment. We broke those things into benchmarks, as you mentioned. So finding the time to get the feedback to students, to our 108 freshmen, so that they have feedback to inform their next step was a big challenge. Also, figuring out how to motivate and scaffold peer feedback and revision, because we recognize that we can't do it all ourselves, so we need peer feedback to be a part of that process. Determining what would be developmentally appropriate standards for our freshmen. So we have these college-ready assessment rubrics that tells us when a senior is college-ready, what's the appropriate level for a freshman? We didn't have that articulated yet, and we're still figuring that out. And also finding and funding, of course, to provide those labs, the soil testing, the water testing, the field trips, allowing for student choice while also making sure we have consistently high expectations. So we want to make sure that every student was being challenged and was walking away with these essential learning outcomes. And Also figuring out the role of grades. So we used to use grades, as many educators do, as a carrot to motivate or a stick to punish. They didn't participate. We definitely wanted to turn away from that. So been experimenting, trying to make sure that our grades are informative and that they're living assessments. They're not punitive, they're not concrete. They're a snapshot of the current and not just of mistakes past as people were learning. And what changed for us? So one was a major new emphasis on feedback, reflection, and revision, and that cycle that was just continuing throughout the project. We were guilty of, and I, after years of teaching, would collect work, would assess, would give feedback, and maybe they'd revise once. But with this style of project, that was happening on a much more ongoing basis. And we weren't the only ones giving feedback. They were also getting it from peers and other adults. So luckily those Gamble Vineyard staff were available through email. They're very responsive. Reflection after each benchmark throughout the project. So students also were reflecting on what they had learned before just moving forward and charging ahead. Also, we had a renewed focus on project quality. So with these CRAs, it wasn't so much, we were given the rubrics, but it wasn't so much about the rubrics. A lot of it was just the focus on the project quality. So authenticity, academic rigor, that they're applying their learning to a real problem that exists in our community. There is some element of exploration. And also our assessment practices, again, changed. A lot more peer feedback. A lot more ongoing feedback. And also as far as grading goes, we would grade the benchmarks, but not the little things in between the benchmarks. So there were a lot of things happening in between the benchmarks that students, that were not negotiable, and students couldn't just opt not to do them, but they were not graded. So they were things that would help them perform on the benchmarks.
So what would you do if the student didn't do them?
I mean, it depends. So like, for instance, we have a few tricks. So luckily the couple years of experience gave us some of those tricks. So for instance, a lab. You couldn't start the lab until everyone in the group has finished their pre-lab. And we look at everyone's pre-lab. So part of the authentic consequence there, if you didn't do your homework and do the pre-lab, is now your team has to like sit around and wait while you finish your pre-lab. And it only takes a couple of those experiences of having your peers be like, oh my gosh, really? That students are more motivated to do it. So we're leveraging peer pressure more than we were with grades. And then also, we're not the peer that's pressuring. You know, we're a support and a resource, so we're not the one who's like hounding them to get it done. And same with journals. We do journals every day. We'll give them a period of time to do the journal. And then we will give them some time to discuss with other people. And then we call on students randomly. And we ask them to at least contribute what was discussed. And if, you know, once or twice it happens in the beginning of the year, they say, I didn't talk about that, then we give them a moment and we all sit there and wait, and the whole class is like, this is boring to sit here while we wait for her to do the journal. So it only takes a couple times of those sorts of experiences. But also students start to, as the year progresses, see the connection between those in-between activities and the benchmarks. And if there isn't a connection, and we see clearly that there's not, we as teachers reevaluate what role that activity really plays in the project. Okay. Also, we used to have a content rubric that was just a checklist. It used to have student explains the nitrogen cycle, check. Student explains the role of decomposers in the ecosystem. But with the CRA rubrics, there was no checklist. This used the same rubric for every project, regardless of the content. So that made content non-negotiable. It's not like they could just neglect some portion of the project and that would be okay. The CRA rubrics focused on the degree to which the content was utilized and understood. So, and if something was missing, we usually gave it back to the student or worked with them through completing the portion that was missing. Also, the quality of student work, we got more meaningful, personal, and well-edited work, of course, we were supporting that more. Much stronger critical thinking and a better understanding of how to identify and provide feedback on critical thinking skills. And also, the students had a much firmer understanding of the content. There was more accuracy and validity behind their claims. So they weren't just rephrasing something they read in a textbook, they were applying knowledge and they were transferring that to a new context, whatever project we were working on. And then we also had much more student work. We used to chase kids. We used to get 50% of the kids to turn in something on the day a paper was due, and then we'd have to chase them down for weeks to get them to turn it in, contact their parents. But since there are so fewer graded assignments, and the students need the feedback before they can go on to the next part, now we have at least an 80% turn-in rate. And even with our brand new freshmen, they have a much better turn-in rate with this. I think the grading model has something to do with that.
And you feel like you have to chase them less?
Yes, absolutely. There's still some that we have to chase, but we're able to focus in more on those kids. Okay. And then these are some excerpts of student writing. Obviously, I won't stand here and read them word for word, but you're welcome to glance through them. And what we really liked about the student writing, again, is that the students are transferring knowledge from either a workshop that we do in class or a lab or a lecture. We do still do occasional lectures, textbooks, websites, whatever it is, they're transferring that to whatever problem they're solving. And they're using obviously accurate language, so scientific lingo as it should be used. And I really like also they talked a lot about systems. So they didn't just define a word. Sometimes in student writing we have a paragraph that's a definition of something. Here, oftentimes we see now students are using the terms in partnership with other terms to explain some kind of system. Okay. All right, and also students had more networking experience. They were working with each other to prepare for the presentation. So their individual papers were an individual contribution to the presentation. So we didn't have one student hanging back on presentation day. Every student had gone through this lengthy preparation process. And so they all had something positive to contribute on presentation day. And also they got to know adults. They got to, even if it was only for a day or two in this project, they got a chance to see that they can have adult conversations with people in the field. Okay, and I already mentioned about everybody contributing to the final product. And also, every student had high expectations again. So it's not like, it's not a team product that some one person could kind of choose to do the cover page and the, you know, the illustrations, but every student contributed and had high expectations with regard to content and critical thinking. And then the last slide is student reflection. So we had a guest speaker toward the end of the project who talked about solving problems, just in general. He's a sustainability consultant here in Napa, and he talked about meeting diverse needs to try to find a solution. And we had the students write on a post-it a reflection based on the project and their presentation. So I really love these little post-it excerpts of wisdom, but the ones I bolded were, I thought, my favorite ones. So don't produce something that is not needed, produce something that is needed, I thought was really cool. So they saw, I mean, just as general as a value, if they're moving on into the business world, I mean, you could apply that knowledge to many contexts. Obviously, big problem equals good was a fun one, but there were a lot of great pieces of wisdom the students had. Yes?
Were they all words of motivation?
Yeah, the kids were, at the end of the project, they were pretty pumped. Usually at the end of a project, once they're through the hard stuff and they've achieved something of a challenge, they're kind of floating on, you know, they're pretty happy and they're inflated and they're feeling pretty good.
And rely by grades too.
Yes. Yep. And they got to taste grades, which is always good if you can feed the students.
How long does the project last?
This project was 6 weeks, so it's a long one.
Yeah.
And this one, the first year we did it as their very first project coming into high school, and we found that that was a little bit too much for them, their very first project. So the next year we did it as their second project. This year we're doing it next semester, and we're going to do a gardening project with the same idea in mind, but not for a vineyard, for hopefully a community garden.
I don't know if you're going to. So how many classes do they take?
The freshmen will sometimes take multiple combined classes. So they take 7 classes, but some of those are paired together. Like, for instance, our classes are paired together. So
and are all the projects the same length, or that's kind of an individual thing within the classes?
It varies. Math and Spanish tend to be shorter projects. They do what's more like problem-based learning, which can be anywhere from 2 to 3 weeks usually, versus the humanities classes and science classes typically have the longer projects.
I'm just curious if there's like this overlapping thing with projects that could stress kids out. You know
Definitely.
What I mean? Like,
absolutely is, yeah. Yeah, and they do get stressed out, especially towards the end of a semester,
yeah.
When many projects are coming to an end.
Yeah.
So that's definitely a challenge.
And how much of these projects take, I keep coming back to this question, I don't know why, how much of the work that's needed for these projects are needed outside of your class?
We really shoot for minimum homework. We want them to have each other as a resource in the
class.
Well,
it's a benefit you're using also, because our quarters last 6 weeks.
Okay.
Like, I don't know if that's your quarter, I mean, if that's your grading period, but our grading period is 6 weeks long.
Okay.
So that would make sense.
Yeah. And so we aim for minimal homework, that they're doing a lot of it at school, but it varies by class. Again, the Spanish and math teachers often have a lot of homework. And the students will do homework based on what they need to do. So if they don't get a lot accomplished in class, then they do have more homework to do.
Yeah, because we had a student panel, and they said like an hour or two outside of class has to go towards whatever the project is needed.
Yeah, and that depends on the student. And of course, if they have a presentation the next day, they probably are, preparing for that.
Yeah.
But as far as writing and researching, a lot of it can be done in class.
In class, mm-hmm. Yeah. 6 weeks, it better be done in class.
Right.
Yeah.
And we have the freshmen again. If I were teaching seniors,
see,
I would probably.
Too. My load is all freshmen.
So I like to give them as much time in class, especially some of the kids don't have internet at home,
yeah.
Or I like them all to have the resources available that we have in the classroom when they're working on it.
Do we do everything in my class, Sheldon? Well, Sheldon's only one actor. I try to make sure you guys do everything in class.
Mm-hmm.
Well, when I tell them, I don't want to get
I know, as much as you can. But if they don't do it, then they have to do it at home.
Ooh, that sounds like a quote from my class. Don't create homework for yourself.
Yeah, exactly.
It shouldn't have always been like that. It's supposed to be like that.
Did you notice that the first time you did the project, or a project in general, did you notice the difference between, like, I don't know, because the difference between a kid finishing just like classwork versus like having to go on and have a presentation. Can you talk about the difference in like the atmosphere in your class?
Do you mean like a smaller assignment versus working
versus
on
versus like
these
something
projects?
That's high stakes where you have to go present to this group of adults? And I also noticed that the students here, when they're coming to present, they're very professional. And mm-hmm. Somebody told them to wear professional clothing.
Right.
To come in, even though it's a Friday, right? And so I'm just wondering, can you talk about like the buzz level difference?
Oh yeah, definitely. I mean, we have kids. If there's a presentation mm-hmm. going on in any of the classes, all of the teachers know, because you said, of course, they're dressed and they also have their note cards out and they're trying to like sneakily prepare, just as an adult would do. You
right.
know, if I have a staff meeting and I have a big presentation right after, I'd probably be glancing at my notes too.
Right.
So I think, and that's reasonable for them to learn how to manage their time too with those conflicting priorities. But definitely if they have an assignment that is low stakes,
mm-hmm.
just turning it into the teacher, it's much lower turn-in rate. You know, and we sometimes still do that. We'll give them just an assignment and it's not totally directly related to the final product. And usually those are the ones where we don't get a great response rate or engagement is a bigger challenge. So it has to be a really engaging activity. But versus the project, their peers are keeping them on track. Sometimes we still have students who, even with the big presentation coming up, they're kind of opting out, but at least the peers help motivate them.
Mm-hmm.
And we can ask them, you know, are you ready for your presentation? Oh, can you give me a run through of what you're gonna say? Or can I see your benchmark? Can I see what you've done so far? So we have a good conversation topic besides just look up that definition or,
right.
you know. fill this out. I saw you had a question.
Yeah, I got a lot now. Do you ever feel like the students lose interest over the 6 weeks of doing the same thing every day?
Yeah, they definitely can, and especially depending on the student, and having the adults tends to make it more engaging.
Right.
And also if they have some choice and if there's some level of competition. So in this one, we said like they're gonna choose the best one. So if there's some level of competition, it's kind of makes it more engaging. But that's always a challenge. Sometimes kids, yeah, over 6 weeks can start to lose steam. And we talk about, we now do a brain project at the beginning of the year. It's about like goal setting and how, when you have a goal, is it always fun when you're working towards the goal? If you want to be a soccer player, is practice always fun when you're running up the stairs to try and increase your endurance? And so they kind of start to equate like their larger goals, longer term goals with some of this stuff. Like I know now one of my students who is opting out a lot wants to be a parole officer. So I'll talk with her about wanting to be a parole officer, and I don't guilt her. I don't say you have to do this if you want to be a parole officer. But knowing that she knows that I know what her goals are, I think helps help her, you know, connect what we're doing in the classroom to her success. And so I think connecting what's happening to longer term goals, even if there's not a personal interest in the project, helps.
And then do you
That's
think
a challenge.
You can, oops,
I said it's a challenge, though, always.
And do you think you can cover much more work in 6 weeks than just like covering one like
assignment?
Or even like just one content? And like, do you think you can cover more? You know, like I just feel like 6 weeks is just like dragging along, and you could be covering so much more if it was just like the traditional way, like introduce, like review, test, and then that's that.
Mm-hmm.
Do you think you can learn more? Like,
well,
if it was to be just doing it the traditional way. You know what I'm saying? You know what the traditional way is, right?
Oh, absolutely. Yeah,
yeah.
I learned that way. I went to Napa High, so
yeah,
that's the bigger high school here in Napa that didn't do project-based learning when I was in high school. But I think that way works for some students who are good at school. I was pretty good at school, and I liked school. That worked for my personality and my learning style, but there are a lot of students who are not really that into school or aren't into, you know, don't care as much about an A versus a C, for instance.
Right.
Whereas those C kids could be A students if we find other ways to structure their learning.
Exactly.
But we do, the thing that I like about the projects is they're not just studying biology, they're also learning about all these other skills. They're learning about writing, they're learning about history, they're learning about the culture in Napa, they're learning about math when they're calculating things and deciding, they're learning about earth science when they're learning about like the sun and the path it takes. So especially in science, there's like this spiral method of teaching where if you come back to concepts throughout the year in different contexts, at it from a different view, they're more likely to remember it longer term. And also, if you're talking about something, you're more likely to remember it longer term. So I think that the fact that they have kind of a traumatic event at the end of the project where they have to present and it's in a high stakes environment helps them remember what they have to do. I think of my most memorable experiences of things that I talked about or maybe there's some fear associated with it. And I think that does help solidify them.
During that 6 week period, how many field trips?
For this one, just the one field trip, but it varies. I mean, we would love to do more, but given finances and, you know, who's able to give us a field trip, or are we, because we can't charge students for field trips, so we have to find other ways. So it varies.